Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and friends of the Heinrich Böll Foundation and the American Academy. Let me welcome you warmly to this evening's event, which we have organized together with the American Academy, and which we have named Russia and Putin from a Historical and Economic Perspective. My name is Gregor Ensbring. I'm the representative of foreign and security policy of the foundation, and we organize events like this series of talks about foreign policy. So I have the duty to apologize for the tight space. The larger hall unfortunately was not vacant tonight, and our guest Professor Padma Desai could speak on this subject only tonight. I hope you do feel all right nevertheless, and I hope you will gain some insights tonight on an evening which is again a historic day, in the sequence of many other historic days. Today, 25 years ago, on the 22nd of June 1989, Checkpoint Charlie was deinstalled. That was 25 years ago, which was a strong symbol, a symbol of the final end of the Berlin Wall that had come down, and that the Iron Curtain belonged to history. At the time, people talked and wrote about the end of history. They wrote that the war of ideologies has come to an end, that fascism and communism have been thrown on the scrap heap of history, and that the victory of liberal belongs to the market and to liberal democracy. That was the time of the thesis of the end of the history. Maybe at that time it was plausible. As I said, the Iron Curtain had come down, and arbitrary regimes between East Berlin and Moscow seemed to have ended, and the confrontation of blocs between East and West apparently had come to an end. Today, a quarter of a century later, geopolitics is back into the political arena. It smacks of Cold War and a new arms race. And today we deal with Russia and with threats and a new war in Eastern Europe from another perspective. In the past 25 years, under Gorbachev and Yeltsin, tested democracy. Let us not forget. And our honorary guest, Professor Padma Desai, virtually was present 20 years ago when Russia tried democracy and a market economy. She will say something about that in more detail later on. And instead, we today have a new Tsar, if you will, by the name of Vladimir Putin. And as regards partnership with Russia, or modernization partnership, is something we cannot talk about anymore. We are all compelled to think from a new perspective. We are forced to understand this new situation in the world and in Europe. We try to analyze it. As you see, the word understand I found difficult to use, and we try to understand this new situation and to interpret it, thus the situation in Russia. And the Heinrich Böll Foundation, as you know, has organized a number of events on this subject. It was conceived and organized by my colleague Walter Kaufmann, the head of the Department for Eastern Europe, and he is at the same time responsible for Russia. He will guide us through the evening, and he will facilitate the exchange of views, and he will also then be the moderator of the discussion with the audience. today, and I will come to the end now, we hope to gain new perspectives on Russia and Putin, new perspectives on an evening we have organized in cooperation with the American Academy. We are allowed to do so because we feel really honored that the Heinrich Böll Foundation can be the host of this year's Richard von Weizsäcker's Academy. Our guest tonight is Professor Padma Desai. Let me introduce her. She comes from the Columbia University in New York. There she is a professor for comparative economic systems and director of economics. She's the director of the Center for Transformation Studies. As I indicated briefly, she was a former member of the Council on Foreign Relations. She was a consultant to the Russian government, the Russian Finance Ministry. On behalf of the American Ministry of Finance back in 1995, that was at a time we hardly prefer to remember. She published a lot in specialist magazines about the planned economy in the Soviet Union. Later, she researched on economic reforms in Russia. And to mention some books and publications, in 2003, she wrote a book, Paul Krugman, called the previously best book about the financial crisis. It was called Financial Crisis, Contagion and Containment from Asia to Argentina. So a wide range of subject included. Ladies and gentlemen, friends of the Böll Foundation and the American Academy, Professor Desai is going to give us a 20-minute presentation. Then we will have an exchange of views of 25 minutes, moderated by two experts in the panel. And then I hope we'll have an interesting time of questions and answers with you. I hope we'll have a very interesting evening. And I'd like to ask Professor Desai to start her presentation.
If you feel more comfortable without them, please remove them. Later on.
Thank you very much for that wonderful introduction. I'm very happy to be in Berlin. It's one of my favorite cities. I've been here often. To be associated with the American Academy in Berlin. I will restrict my comments to 20 minutes. I lived in the Soviet Union in the city of Odessa in 1964, before most of you were born. So I go a long way back, and my experiences of those times as I traveled from Odessa to Kiev in Ukraine, to St. Petersburg going up north, to Riga in Latvia, and I was wearing a sari and my red dot, and Russians would dash towards me, throw something in my hand, and run away. 1960s. And I didn't know how to react. But I can talk about those experiences at length in the question hour. But even before that, why Russia is the question which Russians asked me often in Odessa itself. And I would say, because of Dostoevsky. Dostoevsky. I said, of course, my father's library. My father had brought tons of books from England, and Crime and Punishment was there. I read Crime and Punishment in English translation of Constance Garnett, and I said, I have got to read this this in Russian? So I went to Harvard on an American fellowship in 1955, and I also registered in the Slavic department and started learning Russian. That is how far back as I go, but I have countless experiences of how Russians react. When I say I'm an American citizen, she's an American citizen? No, they refuse to believe it. And there are countless stories about that. But rather than go back to those things which I can take up in the question hour, Khrushchev, 1964, when I was there, the speech which he made before the 1956, before the 26th Congress of the Communist Party, mildly criticizing the communist system, then retracting his criticism because he was afraid that he would be, you know, taken to task by the Politburo. That was Khrushchev. But there was some freedom compared to the Stalinist days of the 1930s. Certainly, people felt freer. Khrushchev became the leader in sort of 1955 after Stalin's death. And so the Russian humorists went to work. I mean, Russian jokes, I love them because they are so intellectualized and they're a beautiful commentary on the political system. So how did the joke go under Khrushchev? Well, what happens? Valentina Tereshkova, the Russian Soviet astronaut, comes from space pregnant. So it created a dilemma for Khrushchev. Either he had to believe in immaculate conception, or he had to admit that an American astronaut was already in space. So that was Khrushchev's dilemma. And this Indian students who were studying in Odessa Institute, they came with lots of jokes from those days. But Khrushchev was in his mild way, a liberator. But Brezhnev, who succeeded him, 1965, was it? There was some tightening. The economy was going down. It was a planned economy. Prices were fixed. The planners decided what each factory should produce of how much and what design and what specification. Wages were fixed. So you can imagine the economic growth was going down right into the 1980s. And but there was still ambition. Brezhnev, the Americans had sent a man on the moon. And so Leonid Brezhnev calls a few astronauts in his office, Russians, and he says, "We are going to outcompete the Americans. How, sir? We are going to send you to the sun." This is in the joke, of course. So, to the sun, "Do you think I'm an idiot? I'll send you at night to go to the sun." So that was the joke under Leonid Brezhnev, and the economy going down, but we have to go to the moon kind of an ambition. And guess who then becomes the leader in 1985? Mikhail Sergeyevich Gorbachev, whom I met once in his office. Gorbachev he brought about winds of change. I'm quoting the American historian Martin Malia, winds of change. Perestroika and glasnost. Perestroika meaning some economic restructuring. It was not very sort of bold or basic. It was just giving the collective farms some freedom of maybe you own that piece of land in this 2,000-acre farm and do what you want, kind of freedom. wages were lifted sort of from their fixed levels. And glasnost, meaning openness, that also didn't go very far. Well, the Communist Party elections to the Communist Party everywhere in the republics and the Communist Party Politburo, the election should be made a little bit open, freer. Who gets elected in these positions, we should be a little bit free, that kind of a glasnost. But, and he also visited Erich Honecker, the East German leader, and he told Erich Honecker, you should do what I am doing in the Soviet Union. Those were the words he told the East German leader. But it took quite a while before that was to happen, right? Mikhail Gorbachev was always worried that he could be removed by the Politburo of the Communist Party because he was appointed by them. And when I met him, I said, you should have contested the election openly like Boris Nikolaevich Yeltsin did. He was in, 1992, early February. Oh, yes, he said, it was a mistake on my part. He openly admitted that. And so comes Boris Yeltsin on the scene, and let us get rid of the planned economy. Let us get rid of the command system under the Communist Party. But planned economy, meaning Yegor Gaidar, Anatoly Borisovich Chubais, Boris Nemtsov, all of them my close friends, the reformers whom Yeltsin described as my kamikaze crew in an interview. This is my kamikaze crew, and we are going to bring about a change in the planned economy, free up wages, prices, and above all, free up the enterprises, the state-owned enterprises. The state, of course, 1997-1998 ran budget deficits, and the owners, the oligarchs, who grabbed as this the nickel industry, the aluminum, the energy sector as they were privatized. I mean, you have all heard about Mikhail Khodorkovsky, right? They took charge of these assets and they gave some cash in the Soviet budget. For bailing out the Soviet budget around 1997-1998. But the privatizers, then, as I said, the jokesters went to work again. So an American visitor goes to visit a Russian friend, country estate, and the Russian, who is an oligarch, he says to the visitor, you see, I have three swimming pools. This one with cold water is for those who like to swim in cold water. This one with warm water is for those who love to swim in warm water. And this one without water is for those who do not swim. This was the joke. So, Mikhail Gorbachev, but there was another story which circulated, which Gorbachev himself knew. And in one of his speeches in New York City, he referred to the joke. How did the joke go? The joke said, Sergei is standing in a long line of bread. Gorbachev, oh, there were still lines. And so Alexei comes to him and says, Sergei, we have to do something. So Sergei says, what? He said, Alexei says, I'm going to the Kremlin and I'm going to kill Mikhail Sergeyevich Gorbachev. After a while, Alexei comes back. And so Sergei asks him, did you kill Mikhail Gorbachev? And Alexei says, no, the line at the Kremlin was longer. So I come back. So Gorbachev himself told this joke. But I think his mistake was, we can discuss this at length, not to really sort of, the ideas were there, perestroika, restructuring, glasnost, political reform, were not broad enough. They were not institutionalized enough, and so they didn't make too much of an impact. Comes Boris Yeltsin. There was an enormous war between the two of them. And Yeltsin, his crew of reformers, sorry, I mixed them up with Gorbachev's, but Anatoly Chubais, Yegor Gaidar, and Boris Nemtsov, Sergei Dubinin, who was the chairman of the Central Bank of Russia, were all under Yeltsin, not under Gorbachev. And Yeltsin referred to them as my kamikaze crew, and Chubais was his favorite of all of them. Chubais reformed the privatization of assets, especially small assets, of shops and little bookstores, and just give them away to the current managers, sell them off. But the big assets, the oil industry, the nickel industry, and so on, that, of course, took time, and the oligarchs, some of them still continue operating under Vladimir Putin, but under Putin's authoritarian hold. So Yeltsin, retires, and he himself appoints Vladimir Putin as his successor. And in an interview which I cite in my Conversations on Russia book, Yeltsin says that Putin is not a maximalist. He's not a maximalist. What did he mean by that? What he meant by that was that the economy is in disorder because we have privatized the assets, we have freed some of the prices. So if raw material prices go higher than final goods prices, the enterprises are making losses. And when they make losses, they do not pay wages to the workers. From 1994 to 1997, millions of Russian Soviet workers were not paid wages. And my co-author and I published a book, Work Without Wages, which was published by MIT Press, where we described this whole process of millions of workers not being paid wages. How did the managers took the decision whom not to pay wages? For how long? Didn't it create turmoil in the system? But it worked. And Yeltsin, therefore, Vladimir Putin is not a maximalist. But lo and behold, feeling which Vladimir Putin early on expressed was that he remarked that the breakup of the Soviet Union was the greatest political tragedy of the 20th century. Just think of it. What do the republics Tajikistan, Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, Armenia, what do they think of the Soviet Union? No, he was not ready to think about that. It was the greatest tragedy, political tragedy of the 20th century. And if possible, he was ready to recreate a Eurasian Union. A Eurasian Union in which he would bring maybe Belarus, Lukashenko. He and Lukashenko just about go along like this. They are not close. How about Georgia? Georgia, the tiny republic. Mikhail Saakashvili had to flee. And Abkhazia, Ossetia, Southern Abkhazia, these little regions of Georgia are under Russian control. So does Georgia have a chance of becoming a member of the European Union? I don't think so, because why would the European Union want to have a member country which is dismembered somewhat and has tension with Russia? The question of Ukraine, very complicated. I lived in Kiev, saw the Podzemlyennye Pishcheri, the underground caves in Kiev, talked with Ukrainian friends. They all spoke Russian. It's sort of so complicated because in lots of respects, the connection is, I mean, Russia's Tsar started in Kiev, in Ukraine in the 13th century. That is as far back as they go. And the language, the culture, the Russian Orthodox Church, there are so many connections. So when we talk with Ukrainian friends, they almost start crying that, what is happening? We were so close. But I said the Maidan uprising, mostly by youngsters, who probably wanted Ukraine to join the European Union, that started Vladimir Putin to think seriously about what should be done in Ukraine. We have sufficient evidence that the eastern part of Ukraine, the Russian minority there is quite active in harassing Ukrainians, in creating small disturbances on the airports and in the provinces of Lugansk and Donbass. They can also be create problems because that is where a Ukrainian industry is. The steel making industry is in the eastern part. And the Ukrainian economy is not doing well. The growth rate has been declining. The hryvnia, the currency, going down. And the oligarchs. And with the oligarchs, you get corruption. So Petro Poroshenko, the president of Ukraine, how much can he manage given these circumstances? And so the IMF is active with loan to revive the economy, to revive the hryvnia, the currency. But that is going to be a very slow process. The sanctions, of course, as a result of Putin's active interest in eastern Ukraine, is not making things easy. Now, the sanctions, the What has it done to the Russian economy? Well, of course it has affected the growth rate of the economy. The growth rate for the current year would be around maybe 3.5% GDP growth rate. But this economy can grow higher. I mean, from 2000 to 2007, the annual GDP real growth rate of Russia was 7% per annum. But that was, of course, the oil prices were high in those years also, and that helped. But from 7% to 3.5% currently forecast is worrisome. But I think the Russians with whom I talk, whom I meet, the reaction is sort of twofold, at least. I mean, excluding Vladimir Putin's saying that it was the greatest tragedy, the breakup of the Soviet Union, we will create a Eurasian Union. But the rest of them, the advisors, the finance ministry, the economic policy person, the development minister, if you meet them at Davos, they would say, well, you know, we'll do fine. Our people are doing okay. I would say, why do you say our people are doing okay? I mean, there are shortages of consumer goods. You have even banned potatoes coming from Poland, the sanctions, a reaction to the sanctions. The sanctions on the rest of the goods are even more extensive. Oh, our people have seen such days in the past, and we will go through this now and in the short future. I said, you know, even in a country like India, where democracy is functioning, you can't talk like, no leader can talk like that, that our people will manage somehow. I mean, the politicians have to find a way of what you do about the situation, but they don't look at it that way. And these are some of the policymakers themselves. And the inflation rate in the range of 15 to 16% annual, compared to what, I don't know, the German inflation rate, maybe less than 1% annual, but the US is 2% annual inflation rate. And it's quite high. And it's therefore a worrisome situation economically. And what does the prime minister say, Dmitry Medvedev? Medvedev says, well, we will undertake de-offshorization, meaning de-offshorization, by which he meant telling Russian industry not to go offshore, de-offshorization. Don't go offshore in Cyprus or somewhere else. Remain in Russia and develop industry, whatever, technology here in Russia. That is one. And then 2 days ago, he came out with a list of items. So we have sanctions. We are not able to import so many consumer goods. But so what? He said, we can grow sugar. Russia growing sugar? Grain, vegetables, these are the items he mentioned. Potatoes, of course, potatoes grow everywhere. So we'll manage. But this is how the leaders are talking. And Anatoly Chubais, who is my surviving close friend, Gaidar passed away. Boris Nemtsov was killed. I am hesitant of contacting Anatoly because I would worry about him. So Russia has kept me active for a very long time. I can describe lots and lots of incidents, stories from way back. Why Russia? I'm asked by Russians because of Dostoevsky. He's so disturbing, they tell me. So I say, what is the point of venturing into a scholarly enterprise which is not disturbing? So that's why I am in Russia. Or I go dressed like this. You're an American citizen. They can't believe it, that an American citizen can look like me, a brown woman, because they are still getting used to the diversity of how diverse America is ethnically. That, and the final story with which I'll end, it was 2 years ago I was departing from friends, Russian friends. They love their country, Matushka Russia. They asked me, I said, you know, I have to go because it's getting late and I'm catching a plane early morning. I'm going home. So they asked me, where is home? So I say, America. And they say, Как тебе не стыдно? You should be ashamed of yourself that America is your home, the way you look. Well, on that note, I would end. But maybe I can tell just one joke about Putin and Medvedev, which a Russian friend told me very recently. So Putin and Medvedev go to a restaurant in the joke. And so Russian, as you know, has no articles, the language. So the waitress asks Putin, what will you have? So Vladimir Vladimirovich says, I'll have steak. How about vegetable? So Putin says, vegetable also will have steak. On that note.
Ja, ganz herzlichen Dank.
Thank you very much indeed, Mrs. Desai. I'm so happy that you cracked in the end a joke about Putin, because I thought you, not even you, can think about jokes when we talk about Putin. This makes it easier when we discuss the time of Putin in Russia. You have really drawn a wide range from the post-Stalinist time, and the question is, although it is too early for a historical description, at least Putin is in power since 2000, and since the end of the 90s, and as far as the historical importance and his first presidency, maybe there will be a third and a fourth presidency under him. Who knows how we will assess this, his historical importance in this era. Is he a consolidator? I found an article of 2006 and 2008 in Foreign Affairs when you wrote, give Putin a chance. The political consolidation and the restoration of political authority is the prerequisite for economic development in Russia. Do we have to see it in the same way today, or do we draw different conclusions today? I think this is what we should be discussing the next 15 to 20 minutes, and then we will open the debate to involve all of you. First of all, I would like to invite Stefan Meister, who's in charge of the program for Eastern Europe and this German Society for Foreign Policy in Berlin. He's a good acquaintance and a good friend of mine and a frequent visitor to the Heinrich Böll Foundation. His comments on the historical description of Mrs. Desai and the first answer to the question how sustainable he thinks the system of under Putin can be. Thank you, and thank you for the invitation as well and the opportunity to take part in this discussion at the Heinrich Böll Foundation. And thank you for the lecture you have given and the historic perspective you have presented to us. I think in the day-to-day policy and the activities of crisis management, we should widen our horizon and to see things in a historic perspective time and again. I took down a few notes. I do not want to mention too many details. Let me just pick out a few thoughts and try to answer your question, how Putin can be categorized historically. He's a historic person, after all, by now. I'd like to come back to the much-quoted sentence that the collapse of the Soviet Union was the biggest catastrophe in the 20th century. I think this is what many Russians thought, and it is not only a geopolitical statement, it was a statement he was deliberately making to the Russian people for whom the decay of the Soviet Union was a socio-political and a personal crisis. And the book of Zinnya Aleksevich, Second Hand Sign. I have to think of it time and again after I read this book. I had to think of the disruptions she described in the then Soviet Union and the social decline and the identity crisis that came up by the end of the Soviet Union. I think this is the target of this sentence, but he meant it in a state context. That meant the weakening of the Russian empire, but the society as a whole also perceived it as a major disruption, and there is a connection between Putin and the Russian society. So I would like to see this in this context too. I should not say that Putin wants to restore the Soviet Union. I think he's too much of a realist. I think he wants to retain the power on the post-Soviet area, for which he has developed a number of instruments. And this influence he wants to maintain involves a lot of costs. Both the Eurasian Economic Union is expensive. This is something not only of benefit for Russia. He creates loyalty for paying these states to join the Eurasian Union. I think it is a system of incentives or a system of subsidization for Belarus or Armenia. And as far as South Abkhazia and South Ossetia and Transnistria, as far as gas supplies are concerned, what costs are involved for Russia. This is negative. This is an imperial policy having nothing to do with an economically thinking objective. In my opinion, this is just a matter of power politics where the Russian taxpayer will pay the bill in the end. What is it that is it what weakens the country economically? I think a similar calculation has to be made about sanctions. Why does Putin not react to the sanctions as we expected, or some of us expected? Because he has a different cost-benefit calculation. He does not think in economic terms. He is not advised by economists, but by security people who think about the security aspect. And for him, the economic costs, he accepts these economic costs because he wins political gains. The energy system under Putin in 2013 or in 2011, in 2012, he was in a deep crisis of legitimacy, below 40% of popularity. And after the annexation of the Crimea, he has opened up a new resource of legitimacy, which is part of his cost-benefit calculation. So he says, I pay the economic costs, which gives me support rates of over 80%, maintaining the conflict with the West, which is a legitimacy benefit for him. And in the end, we also have a debate going on in Russia about the economic discourse under the process of Western isolation should take place. And many Russian politicians around Putin argue that isolation is positive. Sanctions are positive because they will strengthen the Russian economy. We produce products ourselves. We do not import them from the European Union, but we make our own agricultural products, our own machines, our own food. So from our own strength, we will be able to develop economically. If you ask Russian economists, and not only Russian economists, they say this will not work out. This is the Soviet model. This will not work either today in a globalized world where the Russian budget is depending on the export of oil and gas. This will not work out, and there is a lack of know-how in the end. There are deficits in the education system in Russia in order to cope with this innovation. Russia has a technical know-how deficit of below 2%. And it is not able to generate this development on the basis of its own strength. This brings me to the following points. Russia does not have a sustainable economic model, which is part of the crisis. This crisis of now started in 2008, 2009, when it became clear that the growth model of Putin, growing oil and gas prices, do not work anymore, and from then on, experiments started on how to save that system. The way of Medvedev, a mild opening of discourses, but no major changes of the system did not function. It was perhaps dangerous for the regime. In 2011 and 2012, we saw the demonstrations in Moscow and St. Petersburg. So in the end, the decision was taken against an economic modernization process and for a conflict with the West, for oppression inside the country, and a rigidization of the system because of the fear when political modernization would take place, this regime would lose its power. Let me add one more aspect on the historical categorization. I think for many Russians, Putin is seen so positively because of the experiences of the 1990s after the social economic decline and the crisis of identity of many Russians in the 90s in a state that was weak, robbed by oligarchs, that's privatized that state. Putin was the person who stabilized that state and who made it possible for the people to enjoy an enormous economic prosperity within a short period of time, a prosperity the Russians never enjoyed in their history before. Many critics say this growth existed despite Putin, because of rising oil and gas prices of $15 to $20 per barrel by the end of the 1990s, of almost $150 per barrel, an enormous growth of prices for oil and gas. So I think there's something in it. I don't think Putin's model was sustainable, although the ideas of the years after 2000, Hermann Kleef, and his ideas did not make it possible. This stability made it possible to generate growth and to allow for stability. And I think the Russians are thankful for this. This is one important building block for the high support rate, approval rate of the population for Putin. Let me add two more aspects. The disintegration of Russia. We had a major regionalization under Putin. A federal reform started in order to stop the disintegration, and he broke the power of the oligarchs. I think we have to see that period in several periods. There was a reform period up to 2003, and at the same time, the consolidation of power of Putin. There was an enormous increase of prosperity until 2008, but also actions against this civil organizations, NGOs, and in the end, in 2008-2009, under Medvedev, when they tried a mild opening and a fundamental rupture in 2012, when the system opted for a conflict, when the Putin regime decided, when it turned out that he is not the president of all Russians anymore, but of a majority of the Russians, which excludes the option for a Europeanization. Thank you very much. Mrs. Desai, first of all, on the historic categorization under Putin, do you think that it was the year of 2012 when the decisive disruption took place? Until 2008, the first two presidencies were generally a positive phase of consolidation. What happened? And your assessment that 2008-2009 were positive years, what happened that this judgment has changed so much for the negative?
What happened in 2008-2009? I mean, 2008 was the worst year of the financial crisis. And it continued in 2009. And that affected the decline in the demand for oil the world over, including by the European Union, by the United States, by China, and a decline in the growth rate of the Russian economy. The economy, which was growing from 2000 to 2007 at the rate of 7% per annum, was now growing at 3.54% per annum. And so Vladimir Putin is thinking of, you know, some extraordinary measures are necessary for reviving the economy. But if you go back to Yeltsin, why did Yeltsin nominate Putin when he retired as his successor? He said
He is not a maximalist. That is to say, when Yeltsin retired, the economy was in a very disorderly condition because assets were privatized, prices were freed, wages were freed, and enterprises were not paying taxes to the government. The government was not able to manage the pension fund. So his viewing, Yeltsin's viewing, that Putin would be able to restore some order to the situation. But I think, I do like to think that Putin increasingly, I mean, up to 2010, it was modest. But I think the Zapadnicheство, westernizing, was not part of his thinking. I mean, think of it. This man was a KGB agent. What does he want to do with the NGOs in Russia, financed with American money? You get out of Russia. And then Dmitry Medvedev, you remember what he said, what Dmitry Medvedev said when he became prime minister way back? He said, Russia is a corrupt, oil-based economy. That is what the prime minister of Russia said way back. Now today, he is totally, as I said, the changed man, the vegetable in the joke, which the Russian humorists talk about. So it is the restoration of order. But think of it. I mean, is it necessary to bring about so much authoritarianism in Russia? I mean, think of a country like India. I mean, so it is 15 languages, so much diversity, cultural, religious. So what would the new prime minister, Narendra Modi, who is very popular, think of? Why doesn't he become an authoritarian leader? You know, the economy would grow faster and better if I tighten up the press, free opinion, and all that. But is that the way to go? Didn't Vladimir Putin have sort of a model whereby, okay, we will monitor you, the NGOs financed by the United States, we will continue cooperation with the United States and the European Union. Whatever we can learn from you by way of technology, by way of management, we need that. When, you know, in 1990, I lived in Moscow for months at a time. McDonald's was there, flourishing. And my Russian friend would come with little packages, you know, and I would ask Vladimir, what is this? Oh, I'm going to Nizhny Novgorod to see my family. And these are the hamburgers I'm taking for my family from Moscow to Nizhny Novgorod. So this was a country which could not, you know, make, this is an assembly line production of hamburgers. A hamburger patty there, then you make a little ball, then you make the patties, then you put it in the bread, and then you bake it. That was assembly. They couldn't do it. I mean, so you needed McDonald's for doing that. Okay, so in technology, in management, you go to the universities in Moscow, in Nizhny Novgorod, in other places. They're so behind in managing departments of their universities. So why not learn from foreign countries? What is wrong? I mean, after all, didn't in the early 20th century, Russia learn some technology from Germany? I'm talking about way back, more than 100 years ago. Am I not right? Yeah, so what's wrong about it? I mean, the Chinese, they have become a major power, growing at 10% per annum for two and a half decades. How did they manage it? By inviting American investors. Big way. Come and teach us. So what's wrong? After all, Russia got the ballet from the French. Right? Am I right? Yeah. So, I mean, now today they are the superpower in ballet, the Russians. So what is wrong about learning from foreign countries where you are a little behind? That is the problem with Vladimir Putin. And if he's the leader, okay, his approval rating is 87%. How did he manage that? Okay, but gradually authoritarian policies, monitoring the press, monitoring the internet system, suppressing free opinion. The young reformers, the young friends of mine with whom I cannot correspond anymore. So did he need to do all that in order to, wasn't there an alternative model whereby you manage the foreign NGOs, whereby you invite foreign technology, and the country grows. And Dmitry Medvedev saying we can do everything together, everything in Russia by ourselves. What kind of a policy making is that?
Ich habe davon gehört, dass leider
I have heard that, unfortunately, the Russian laws on NGOs and other measures enjoy growing popularity even in India. I hope this is not entirely true, but as far as Russia's turning away from the West is concerned, and as Stefan Meisner wrote, is there a threat of an turning away or a restoration of a political economy that is turning away from the world economy? Do you think this self-isolating economy survive? Can it develop? That's the first question. And the second question is, if at all this Russian society, this Russian economy turns away selectively from the enemy West, what role do other powers play, like India, China, Brazil, that have united into the organization of BRICS? Does Russia have alternatives to the West, which is described as a declining region, as a decadent region, not only by Russian philosophers? And if at all one would seek guidance in China and other regions, how do you assess such reasoning?
Second question first. The relationship with China and the BRIC countries, India, Brazil, China, the Chinese are very smart. I mean, they can outsmart everybody, including the Americans and the Russians, certainly. The Russian one proposal is to, okay, we will not be able to sell energy to Europe in a steady, foreseeable manner, so why don't we sell energy to China, which needs energy very badly, and it imports energy from the Middle East. So what do you do? Well, you have to first of all create huge pipelines, Eastern Siberia to Western Siberia to Eastern Siberia, going all the way to the Chinese territory. So who is going to finance that? The Russians, for developing their oil and energy fields, they earmarked about up to 20 different locations in Russia, Siberia, essentially, Eastern, Western, and telling the Chinese, please, if you extend loans to us, then these regions can be developed for energy, oil, natural gas, and then we ship it to China. And the total cost was some $400 billion over 40 years or something like that. And the Chinese leadership, what are they going to say? Oh, we are going to think about it. You think they're going to fall in for this kind of a scheme? So India, of course, there was a meeting between the Prime Minister and Vladimir Putin, and the Russians are developing 10 nuclear PowerPoint projects, nuclear industry in India. So that is as far as it goes. But you know, in the old days when I lived there in 1964, when Nehru, Khrushchev were both alive, and the trade was humongous, and it was bilateral ruble trade. So India imported machines, and Russia got lots of consumer goods from India. That didn't last for long. I mean, because the Russians would want to have consumer goods from Korea or from China. And so India would want machines from other places. So that, therefore, the BRIC solution is not that encouraging as it would seem. The first question about, of course, Vladimir Putin is popular. I think his rating runs into 87% among the Russians, and it has gone up. It seems to me that, as I gave you the example of the Russian policymaker saying, okay, our people are deprived of essential consumer goods, but we are managing. Is there something in Russian history where German workers and economically less prosperous population put up with this kind of deprivation for long? Even in India, there might be protests, and if shortages develop to a point where the public begins to feel hurt as a result. I mean, today the consumer goods situation in Russia is awful. That is my feeling, in contrast to what it could have been if you just work out. Isn't it possible to work out some of these issues politically? I mean, the Minsk Agreement. So East Ukraine, leave the Ukrainians alone. I mean, don't have the Russian separatists creating problems with them with the arms which are supplied by Russian authorities. Be creating disturbances in eastern Ukraine. What is the purpose here? As I think, I don't remember if I said that, but the purpose is to keep Ukraine unstable so that Ukraine will never join the European Union. That is his, he doesn't want to militarily invade Ukraine. Just keep it unstable. Just keep Georgia unstable so that these countries do not go into the Western sphere of influence. Now, why? Why all this? I mean, wouldn't it be possible to have a more, if not benevolent, but a positive approach? Mikhail Gorbachev had, Boris Yeltsin had it. Why not? because of his background of, as a KGB agent, because of his view of what Russia's role should be. A country which, with enormous resources, just think of it, a country with enormous resources, with an educated manpower. This is not a poor Asian or African country. Where can it go just with proper planning, proper management, proper collaboration, maybe with Germany, maybe with the United States, maybe with Britain, or maybe with the BRIC countries? Isn't that model possible? Why not? Isn't there something wrong with his mentality? What else can you derive from his activities? The geopolitical maneuvering, grab Crimea, keep Eastern Europe in trouble. So my popularity rating therefore will remain above 80% because the Russian people, we have Crimea. Ukraine is going to stay with us or independent. This geopolitical maneuvering in order to keep his popularity rating high, how long is this going to last?
Yeah, nun hat Frau Deser.
Well, these are quite a number of difficult and uneasy questions Mrs. Desai asked. Can you counter these questions with your questions, perhaps, or a comment? There is a microphone in the hall. Please do make use of it. Here we have the first question. It would be nice if you introduce yourself. I am an honorary ex-steering member at DBAB in Munich. I have experience with East European cooperation. Geostrategic is something which is too short-sighted. If we check the current news, we should be more worried about the approximation between Russia and Saudi Arabia or the prejudice existing in the UN Security Council with regard to the Chinese and the Russians, and the fears you may share or not about an approximation of Russia. And the question should be, where do we see Europe and Russia see in a conflict, be it in the nature of a Cold War, perhaps? What about your geopolitical, is a mediator's role more important? Does he want to play the role of a mediator? Well, we will collect a couple of questions. Barbara von Freitag, I represent the world of NGOs with the NGO Russia Social Forum. I have a question about the population and how far this system is accepted by the society, because you spoke about the resources of legitimacy. I think the strongest resource of legitimacy of Putin is that the bad, evil 1990s will never come back again, and that he is the guarantor that these humiliation of Russia, which was especially a socio-economic crisis in the 90s, will never happen again under his rule. We have new statistics about the high rise of poverty in Russia. We are back to figures we know of the 1990s. 23% of the people in Russia living below the minimum level of existence. And we also have the former minister, finance minister at the World Economic Summit in Petersburg, who warned that Russia will be in a process of decline in a dramatic way. He expressed warnings that it now holds the sixth place among global economies. In the foreseeable time, Russia will rank 20th and would then be in a totally different league of economies. And he referred to the disastrous democratic development in the country and the non-existent pool of manpower in the country. So I would be interested in how far we can make comparisons with the 1990s now, or whether we can make out a scenario which has to do with this degradatia, as many Russians call it themselves under liberal experts, that it will end up exactly there where Putin said Russia will never be back, and that the whole issue of legitimacy will be outdated one day or sooner or later. And the third question? I'm a lawyer. I work in Russia for 25 years now.
My question is the following. Based on everyone's numbers, it looks like everyone's suffering from the Ukraine-Russia crisis. No one is making any benefits. The Ukrainian economy is suffering. The European economy is suffering. I work a lot with Deutscher Mittelstand. I don't know a single company who does business in Russia who hasn't suffered from the crisis. And I also know lots of business partners in Russia who tell me, Philip, my business is suffering tremendously. Given that, why wouldn't Russia and Ukraine be able to reach a commercial solution to the crisis? Namely, they would sign an agreement under which Russia gives Ukraine, buys Crimea from Ukraine in return for a discount contract for gas. Step two, the IMF grants additional loans to Ukraine. Step three, everyone says no American arms go to Ukraine, because one of the biggest problems is that America has been much too aggressive in this, and that's what's made the Russians aggressive towards America. Step four, since America withdraws all of its arms, the Russians also say then no more troops support on the border of the Ukraine. The next step, as you mentioned, one thing that the Russians are very worried about is the Ukraine joining the EU and becoming a competitor. Sign the agreement and say EU will only sign an agreement with Ukraine if Russia approves. And if we were to able to sign an agreement like that and also say Ukraine will not join NATO, wouldn't a commercial agreement like that, if it came from Mr. Poroshenko, be something that we could talk about?
So, schon ein ganzer Lösungsplan hier zu kommentieren. Ich gebe die Fragen also nach.
Okay, the question about the geostrategic position or the direction where Russia would be heading, and the question about the economic decline. Are we back in the 1990s? And will that mean that all resources of legitimacy will they deplete? And so I ask these two questions to the two of you. Would you like to start, Mrs. Desai?
1990s, the economy was in a bad shape, as was described. But 1990s, Putin was not in charge, right? He became the effective leader in 2000. Under Boris Yeltsin, Bill Clinton and Boris Yeltsin, they had enormous chemistry, as Strobe Talbot, the Assistant Foreign Secretary under Madeleine Albright, pointed out. And Bill Clinton's advice or order to his policymakers with Boris Yeltsin is, Yeltsin drunk is to be preferred to any alternative sober. This was the connection between the United States and Russia in those days. And one would have wished if this had proceeded along some constructive lines, as Yeltsin left the economy and the country in a almost chaotic state, wouldn't things have been different? regarding Vladimir Putin, I think what I feel is that he's a very clever man. I mean, there's no doubt about it. But what I think about is that the economy is in a bad shape. As I said, the growth rate will turn out to be 3.5% this year, very low. The inflation rate is 17% annual. Just think about it. It's high inflation. There's a shortage of consumer goods. How do the policymakers, his finance minister, his economy, how do they fight this situation? How does Alvira Nabulina, whom I have met a couple of times, the chairman of the Central Bank of Russia, handle monetary policy? She has let go of rubles, almost quantitative easing, as in the European Monetary Union, flood the economy with rubles, so it will come down, the rate. And so what will happen? Exports will take place. What exports? What is Russia going to export? Because the ruble is cheap. So the policy making apparatus is not working. And if there are any counter voices, the lady there, she was referring to Alexei Kudrin, the former finance minister. He expresses his worries. He's saying that our low growth rate is going down. Unemployment rate is now 6% of the workforce. Investment has been stagnating at a low level for 5 years in a row. There are no, if I remember right, 30% of GDP, the investment rate. It's not moving up. So there is a worry. And it would seem to me, that's what Alexei Kudrin says, he's independent-minded, and Putin hasn't shut him up so far. Putin's policy is, there is no widespread discussion of what is really happening in the economy with respect to foreign investment flows, with respect to the ruble valuation, with respect to the stock market or whatever. No open discussion, because opinion is suppressed. Do you think Anatoly Chubais can say anything? If he did, I have no doubt he differs from the current political and economic framework. But he's keeping quiet. He's in Prime Minister Medvedev's office, and I dare not contact Anatoly for his opinion. So I think it is a situation where geopolitical maneuvering, grab Crimea, keep Eastern Ukraine under turmoil, keep Georgia under a bit of turmoil, keep the European Union under a bit of worry, keep Germany under worry. We will cut back energy supply. We will cut back our trade with you. So this kind of policy making, Russians feel good that our leader is showing some macho, some chutzpah. But is it doing them any good? Just think of, if this goes on, where will the economy be 3-5 years from today? Without any investment growth, without any foreign investment flow, without any technology or management coming from outside, and this emphasis of Prime Minister Medvedev of de-offshoreization and let us do everything at home now. Do you think this makes sense for a country like Russia? I mean, which needs to open up. And I tell my young Russian friends who come to see me, I mean, think of your cultural heritage. I mean, think of your music. Think of, I mean, Tchaikovsky. Think of your ballet. Think of your novels. I grew reading the novels of Tolstoy and Dostoevsky, and Chekhov's plays were translated in my mother tongue in India. And I watched Chekhov's plays with my mother in Gujarati. That is your culture, your history. What's going on with you guys? You feel proud of your history, and then whatever you cannot do, like make a hamburger patties, learn from the Americans. What is wrong? Because the Americans don't have the ballet and the music, and they get it from Europe. So, what's wrong with it?
Not the hamburgers.
Stefan,
well, I understand. Did it on the one hand, legitimacy comes back thanks to this foreign policy behavior. On the other hand, the question is, how long will it last? If this development, as you have forecasted, will follow, is this an ideal way to go in the Russian-Ukraine-European relationship? The sellout of the Crimea, an agreement, the EU will accept the Ukraine only if Russia approves. This is the way things should go, so that we do not have an unstable, isolating Russia, which will involve certain risks for Europe as well. One more idea on what Mrs. Desai said. In the end, I think Russian culture, the Russian language, Russian ballet, this is the Russian soft power. This is what Russia makes attractive and what fascinates us about that country. I absolutely agree with her. It is so regrettable that this apparently is no longer the decisive thing in the politics, and that a certain aggressiveness is dominating in our neighborhood. But Russia would have this soft power, I would say. Nevertheless, let me briefly say a few things about three points. The first question, geostrategy. Is it too short-sighted? Where is Putin heading for in his foreign policy? I would like to make a distinction between the post-Soviet area and other regions in the world. The post-Soviet area is the area of influence of the regime. That is where the central conflict lies between Russia, the EU, and the West. And in this region, there won't be compromises. There won't be compromises in the foreseeable time. Talking about global conflicts, Russia has a certain interest in the fact that IS will not enlarge, and that Iran is allowed to sit at the table. This is also about Russia's prestige as a global power. And here, Russia doesn't have the influence it used to have in the post, it had in the post-Soviet area. So these are different categories. These are different approaches Russia uses. What we see is that Russia is trying to ally with countries, to align with countries that belong to the American, the Western, the liberal world, or to form coalitions with authoritarian regimes that apparently offer an alternative model to the Western model. This is a policy we see since 2012 increasingly, and which we have observed partially before. About Barbara Freitag's question, are we on the way back to the 1990s? I think there are some other elements there. We still have a functionable state, which we did not have in the 90s. The oligarchs ruled the state. Today, the people have got something to lose in Russia. They have a achieved a certain level of prosperity, and they have a risk which would make them more loyal to the regime. Nevertheless, we are aware that this economic model will not function. We are aware, nevertheless, that the development of Russia as it now will weaken Russia economically, and that as a consequence, or the reason of the crisis is that the population must be mobilized more against internal and external enemies. This mobilization of the society, which is functioning until now, I do not know where the turning point will be, the economic turning point. We have a state that controls all spheres, that has hardly any opponents. Even the oligarchs depend on that state. And the society, we have an emigration wave, a massive brain drain wave since 2012. I do not yet see this point of return, but the attempt to develop a new social agreement, I don't know where it should be based on a negative perception, an identity against something, against somebody, against external and internal enemies. And the last point, a commercial agreement about the Crimea. As a matter of fact, the Crimea is not the decisive issue. It's not about Crimea and the Ukraine, but it is about the fact that the Russian leadership has triggered a conflict of order in Europe. What should be the ruling order? The post-Cold War order with the Paris Charter, or the CSCO agreement, the sovereignty of states, recognition of borders? Or should it be a geopolitical thinking of power of the 19th century about spheres of influence? The Ukraine is just an end in itself. The regime is trying to improve its negotiating position vis-à-vis the West, but the aim is not, once an agreement has been found about the Crimea, a solution is found. I would contradict that there are only losers. No, China is a winner of this conflict. The Europeans and the Russians are the losers of this conflict. But China will benefit. It improved its negotiating positions with Russia. Russia will be able to sell its oil and gas to China at the prices it wants. So this is negative for Russia and in certain areas also for us. So this is not the way to solve this conflict. Now, one last question to the audience, or two more questions, because time is flying. Richard Buchner, Eastern Europe Institute, formally. I would like to ask two specific questions. The first question is about the nuclear armament. Then President Medvedev and Obama signed a nuclear limitation agreement in 2012 to be implemented until 2018. Mr. Meissner, can you say whether the current process of armament, the nuclear armament, is this a breach of this agreement, or can Putin describe it or portray it in such a way that it is part of this agreement? Nuclear armament has been totally forgotten, but it is now making headlines in newspapers again that Russia spends 10% of its budget. It increases the budget by 10% annually, so it also has an economic aspect. The security aspect is much more important. The second question, we all know 7,000 casualties in the Ukraine within 1 year and a half. This is a horrific figure. The question is, what are the costs of the war for Russia? Secondly, there are two different types of interpretation. If it is important that Putin wants only destabilization of Ukraine, to blackmail the West, then this conflict is it manageable in one way or the other? If some NATO analyses are true, that Putin wants to get the access to the Crimea on land, and that he wants to use Sevastopol as an airfield, or that it be enlarged as a nuclear basis. Can you say something about that in more detail? Well, the last question here in the front, the lady. Alex from Greece. I would like to know your opinion how we can solve this problem of the strong reaction of Russia against the globalized economy, because the game with fear and an addiction to finding a new identity is nothing else but a strong reaction against a globalized economy, since they are not yet in a position to take part in these processes of globalization. Let's start with Stefan Meissner, and then Mrs. Desai will have the last word. Nuclear armament, costs of the war. Well, both the reset and the nuclear zero are both part of it. Well, this relationship of trust never worked out. There was a certain, well, a chance when things were done differently at certain times, also on the part of the West, that a certain war would not have happened. But I cannot see that this issue is negotiable between Russia and the USA at the moment. On the contrary, it's being instrumentalized in order to show one's world power status, to show that one has the power of a nuclear strike. They deliberately build up new warheads so that this issue becomes part in the rhetoric and that it plays a certain role in the reality. I don't think Russia has an interest in striking with nuclear arms. No, its intention is to demonstrate its strength. But nevertheless, we have to be careful not to fall back into another spiral of the arms race. We are lacking the instruments of an arms control and of confidence-building measures. The whole CSEO process of international mechanisms and institutions that accompanied us on both sides, and that were weakened since the end of the Cold War. And this makes this so dangerous. This tit-for-tat policy makes it so dangerous. The speechlessness is the problem, and the lack of mechanisms. I have to admit, I do not know what the war will cost. I do not know any figures, let me tell you frankly. But there is no war, actually, between Russia and the Ukraine. Officially, there are just separatists and volunteers who are fighting there. So it is difficult to talk about costs and cost calculations at all. I cannot give you any figures. What does Russia want in the Ukraine? My thesis is, basically, there is no real plan. The Russian policy is rather reactive. The Yanukovych escape was a shock for Russia. The stepping down was prepared, but when the time would come was not clear. And I think what the Russians are doing in eastern Ukraine is a reaction to the situation, to the international situation, and in the country, in Ukraine itself. So it may be possible that they manage one option on the land, that they have it in the on the shelf, but maybe they just leave it there and wait and see to check whether they get from the West what they want. No EU membership, no NATO accession, or no approximation. Let's not talk about membership at the beginning. No economic separation from Russia. like Novorossiya could have been an option, but the problem is the Russian leadership reacts. If certain things would not run the way, they might conclude they need that war. So this bridge, this land way is maybe considered to be necessary. Well, I can leave the last question for you, Mrs. Desai. Do you want to respond to this difficult question as to how a country should be convinced about the advantages of globalization when you interpret the Russian policy as an anti-globalization reaction, as a reaction? You really pleaded for Russia's opening. You used the example of McDonald's, that Russia should be open, that new technologies should be embraced, that foreign investment should be allowed in. But as we have heard, possibly one basic reason of the conflict is that they see themselves as a loser of globalization, which is why they behave like this. What would you respond? How would you convince Russia to open itself?
Very good question. I will tell Vladimir Putin, sit down with your Chinese friend, the leader of China, and listen to what the Chinese have to tell you, probably, that in 2.5 decades, what we Chinese managed to do from the year 1972, I mentioned Henry Kissinger and Richard Nixon, open up American investment to China. And look where China is today. After a growth rate of 10% per annum, GDP, for 2.5 decades. So maybe you can follow the Chinese example. American, Western, German technology, loans, and globalization. I mean, Russia, energy exports, of course, are the main growth possibilities, but Russia is also, the chemical industry is developing, the fertilizer industry. So it is a country where, with effective management, technology, and an educated manpower, they can diversify their export structure also and get into the global markets. Finally, Ukraine. We have been appearing on American TV, Al Jazeera TV, some of us regarding Ukraine. It's a very active issue. And the position I take is that both the Western powers led by the United States and Russia, leave Ukraine alone. Let Ukraine be independent on its own. Ukraine needs its economy to grow, IMF funding, maybe some technological help from anywhere, the reduction of corruption, the reduction of the powers of the oligarchs. That is what Ukraine needs to do. The whole issue of where Ukraine belongs to Russia or to the European Union, just keep it out of any discussion from any negotiations or anything. And you know, the latest quibble on words, what should be the position of Russians in Ukraine? Think of it. So there is a Russian minority significant on the eastern sliver of Ukraine. I mean, isn't there a German minority in Poland? Right? So what does Germany do? You want to grab a couple of cities? Or
where there are where there are significant Germans. I mean, come on, there are 14% of Indian population in India, 140 million. There are 140 million Muslims in India. Of course, Pakistan happened, Bangladesh happened. But do you want some more slicing of the countries? I mean, don't the political powers, the leaders, and the societal leaders, the cultural, say, let us stop it. I mean, there are foreign minorities in almost every country, but you can't just slice the part of the country because there are Russians in Georgia and there are Russians in Ukraine. And there are even a quibble of words. Petro Poroshenko, the president of Ukraine, says we should give decentralization to Russians in eastern Ukraine. Right? What does he mean? Maybe the Russians in Ukraine, in the universities, they can learn in Russian. In some official purposes, Russian can be the language. This has been a perennial question in India. What should be the official language? Should it be English, Hindi, or the local language? I mean, you sort it out. Vladimir Putin, what word does he use for the Russians in eastern Ukraine? Autonomy. Autonomy. What is the word which Petro Poroshenko uses? Decentralization. Just think of what signals are conveyed by the use of words. Don't think of autonomy. There are minorities in countries around the world, but you can't, okay, Russia is next door. But I agree, and this was the point I earlier also mentioned, that Ukraine should be left alone, independent. No EU, no Russia. And Ukraine should develop economically with IMF help, with other countries' technical management help, and the corruption should be reduced among the oligarchs. That should be Ukraine's motto, and that should be also the mandate for European policymakers and for the United States also. Leave Ukraine alone. And maybe that will be the, and sit down with John Kerry and Sergei Lavrov, maybe, and the military leaders on two sides, three sides, US, Ukrainian, Russian, sit down and let's sit down and negotiate and cool it a little bit. That's my answer.
So, ganz herzlichen Dank.
Thank you very much indeed, Mrs. Desai. Has made, as usual, some unusual recommendations that are usually not expressed at a stage of the Pearl Foundation, to recommend a Chinese version to Putin. This rarely happens with us, but that's interesting. We have realized that there is much reason to talk or to think about Russia and to be concerned about Russia. It remains to be seen how the way of Russia's isolation continues. We would not be happy about it. We have to think about how Russia will find back its way to Europe. My thesis is, however, Russia has to become a little bit more European itself, or has to be willing to do so. I would like to thank all of you. Thanks for listening for 2 hours, and especially the interpreters. I would like to thank the American Academy for the good cooperation, and even though those who have come to the Heinrich Böll Stiftung for the first time from the Academy, we would be happy to pay us a visit again. Please remain loyal. Thank you and goodbye.